And we're back with another episode of Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. We're in the marketplace in Copper Lane. Let's see what these guys have to offer. Igrin. Igrin stands behind a stall, polishing a broadsword. The patterned flesh around his eyes is crinkled with age, and the muscles in his arms are knotty and lean, but he holds the weapon with ease. He nods at you. Come to take a look? You won't find a finer collection of armor and weaponry in Defiance Bay. Outside Sunild's, of course. He flashes a crooked grin. What's so special about Sunild? She operates in the Expedition Hall. He jerks a thumb over his shoulder. Sells the best equipment in the city, but Winan keeps her on a short leash. Keeps her fine inventory reserved for chartered expeditionists, members of the dozens, and anyone else he takes a liking to. Alright, let me see what you have for sale. Arms and armor. It's funny we don't have the option to ask him if he sells that special steel or whatever. Borisane. Unique war. Wow, 10,575 coppers. Gotta be out of your mind. The Dwarven clan of Langmere dwelt in the wilds of Nasitak, hunting game and surviving off the harsh land. Summers were brief and winters difficult, but the winter of 2562 AI was one of the hardest in the tribe's long history. A mighty snow leopard had established territory nearby, scaring off much of the game near the village. By Fonaten, the hunters were returning with little more than rabbits, and the winter freeze was nigh. A dozen of the best hunters snuck out across the tundra, determined to hunt the great cat. The beast was craftier than they'd planned, and by Inverno, half of the hunters and most of their hunting foxes had been slain without so much as wounding the leopard. Desperate and furious, one of the hunters crafted a bow from the bones of her slain fox. As her remaining companions looked on, it seemed that all of her rage was channeled into it, into the weapon, while she carved and shaped it. Her work completed, she set off and tracked the beast to its lair. Once she'd killed it, she decorated her bow with its teeth as a reminder of the deed and of the long and tragic hunt. Now black with age and use, this bow is nevertheless fierce to behold. It's studded with the teeth of a large cat, and the notches curve in tight spirals. We can't be getting that yet, and a lot of this stuff, but let's look at it. The Lady's Hand. It's a unique scepter. Plus 20 of grazes converted into hits. Plus 2 accuracy, plus 15% damage. This slender steel scepter is topped with a gilded feminine hand. Each... Oh, it is. It's a hand at the end. Each finger ending in a delicate mother-of-pearl nail. It was forged and crafted by the smiths and artisans of Delwyn, a small town in the foothills of the Magmere Mountains in the southern reaches of the Aedir Empire. The recipient was Lady Riga Adalwin, 3rd Magreffa of Maganon, who had recently emerged victorious from a brutal campaign against her march by barbarians and agents of a rival family. In leading the defense of the march, Lady Riga had lost her left hand. The Emperor had his scepter crafted to reward her sacrifice during the protection of what was then the Empire's southernmost territory. Or created, rather. Unfortunately for the Adelwan family, they only held the Maganon territories for 2 more generations. With little money and no land, the family set out for the young colonies of the Deerwood. The Lady's Hand saw renewed use in battle by Brannan Adalwan, Thane of the Low Meadows during the War of Black Trees. There, Brannan used it to defeat Glenfathan warriors and spirit-animated trees that were marching out of the deep woods. For his service to the colonies, Brannan was made an Earl of the new territory of Blackstand. But bad luck struck the Adelwan family twice. Only a year after establishing a fort on the frontier, Brannan was ambushed by Glenfathan resistance fighters. Finishing their main mission, the assassins then pursued his small family, oh, sorry about that, and killed every member, leaving no heirs to the House of Adelwan. Following the reinforcement of Blackstand's fort by its new earl, the Adelwan family's belongings were distributed according to the known wishes of Brannan. notably the lady's hand, his great-great-grandmother's gift from the Emperor, was bequeathed to Sir Harrig Cardaff, a minor knight of New Hiamar, alongside whom Brannan had fought in the War of Black Trees. More comfortable with sword and shield and scepter and grimoire, Sir Harrig displayed his friend's gift prominently in his home, but it never saw use in battle again. Well, someday it might. Lord Thane's Reach. A unique pike, two-handed. It's a fine weapon. Inflicts -5 accuracy for 5 seconds on hit. +1.8 weapon reach. Lost Thane's Reach was once wielded... Did I say Lord Thane? Lost Thane's Reach. Once wielded by Thane Solmar, Siniad of the Grasp, while engaged in a skirmish against some Glamfellen rebels at the outskirts of New Hiamar, Solmar conquered their leader at the edge of a cliff. The rebels quickly interposed themselves between Thane Solmar and their leader, seeking to prevent Solmar from striking the final blow. A skilled pikeman, Solmar was able to foul every effort to strike him, and he ultimately dealt the rebel leader a mortal wound. Unfortunately, the pike's hooked blade became snagged upon the dying elf's armor, pulling Solmar over the edge of the cliff with his foe. All right. And Shatterstar. A unique warhammer. Sorry, guys. All around Eora, tales circulate about fabulous weapons fashioned from stones that fall from the heavens. Once believed to be gifts from the gods and still often seen as such, these stones are now known to be meteorites. Even so, items crafted from them remain precious. Shatterstar was a hammer forged from a solid block of palisite that was discovered by one of Eothus's faithful shortly after St. Widwin rose to power in Red Saris. It was crafted into a weapon and carried at the head of the Red Saren army during Widwin's march on the Deerwood. As such, it was believed lost at the Godhammer Citadel. The head of the hammer is iron and nickel, laced with yellow and orange crystals. It's held in place by a bronze band jointed to softly jingling rings. So what's the main difference between an arquebus and a blunderbuss? Matchlock, firearms of high power and fair accuracy, arquebuses are prized for their ability to penetrate wizards' arcane veils. We have one of them. Blunderbusses are matchlock firearms used for hunting or in combat against groups of enemies. They can inflict an impressive amount of damage, but fare poorly against armor. Despite this, like other firearms, blunderbusses are capable of penetrating a wizard's arcane veil. A pistol? Pistols are small firearms, but despite their size, they require two hands to reload properly. They are not as powerful as arquebuses, but they can be reloaded much more quickly. Same thing about the veils. I don't want to look at that. Pike's Pride. Unique medium armor. Born into a family of fishmongers, one young Adirin decided he would give up the family trade and take up the sword instead. He swore that he would find greater fortune than ever was bestowed upon his family. When he sought out opportunities to prove himself, however, he was often scorned, for he came from low-born stock and his line had achieved little of note. Discouraged, the lad returned home, only to find that his family, eager to see him achieve his wishes, had pooled what coin they had to commission a suit of armor that might keep him safe. The lad asked a smith to craft a set of gleaming scale armor, bright as the flashing scales of a fish, and just as light and quick. He called it Pike's Pride, and while he wore it, he found himself immune to whatever foul words his detractors might level at him. Okay, it's +10 will. Well, that's no good. -50 knockdown duration. Well, we wouldn't have Ida use it, that's for sure. The Dunier Demon. +2 intellect for this helm. Caswyn was one of the Brishalgwyn of Ir Glanfath who received training from Dear Wooden Animancers around 2785 AI. When Dunreed Row was founded 15 years later, she was one of the first ciphers to join. Though relatively old for an Orlan, she was one of its most enthusiastic and capable agents. Known as the Dunreed Demon, she was ruthlessly methodical and infamous throughout Defiance Bay for prowling the streets in her helmet, searching for clues and connections. At the end of the Saints' War, she was over 40, and she was sent to the Godhammer Citadel to search for traces of Saint Widwin. She never arrived, and years later, her helmet was found on the road from Echo Bay. A winged helm. That's pretty cool looking, eh? Okay. I'll be back for some of this stuff. I don't know. A Warhammer. Let's check out Hild. Ah, another history. You see a dimly lit room with extravagant decoration. Pillows of silk brocade cover the floor surrounding a large velvet-covered divan. A man sits on the divan, his shirt untucked and only halfway buttoned. Behind him stands this elf, dressed in the same lavish finery as decorates the room. Her hips gyrate gently, dancing slowly around the man as she begins to sing. He looks up at her blearily, intoxication clouding his vision. He smiles, tunelessly humming along with her. Her words are too low to hear clearly, but her singing grows more intense. The lights in the room... The lights in the room seem to dim even further, and everything loses focus. She takes his face in her hands, singing directly to him, running her hands down his shoulders and arms until she is holding his hands. The man's eyes grow heavy as he quickly succumbs to sleep, slumping backward. She holds his arms, catching him as he falls, and gently lays him down across the divan. She stops singing when his head hits the pillow, and suddenly the lights brighten back up and everything snaps back into focus. She slips her hand into his pocket, retrieving an item that she places in a small box sitting on a nearby table. She looks back at the man, shakes her head, and escapes into the night. Huh. What's she doing, putting in a box? Lenkil Greatstorm. Another history. You see a man stumble, knees bleeding, clothes torn, eyes dead. His skin is damp with sweat, but he pushes onward. His back is arched, defeated. At his side hangs a bow, strings limp from disuse. He trips through the undergrowth, sightless, ignoring all but the sound of his own anguish. Drink. He comes across a deer, guts spilled across the forest floor, still steaming in the cold night air. A Stelgar, watches him from above, perched on the trunk of an enormous fallen tree. It takes the man a moment to notice his danger, and he seems almost glad for it. The Stelgar unravels itself from the tree, eyeing him carefully. Its distended stomach almost brushes the ground as it jumps down, and the man dives to meet it. For a moment, time seems to slow as man and beast collide. The Stelgar roars, swiping at him with its claws, and soon has him pinned, great yellow teeth and acrid breath ready to end his intrusion. But with a ripping sound, instead the agonized Stelgar is himself gutted from neck to rump. The man exhales deeply, covered in blood, ponderous. Not today. Not today. Huh. Cursed never to die? Or blessed?
Sure.
We can look in yonder barrel.
I'll see what I can find.
and this yonder barrel as well. Is that the fox? Oh no, that's over there. I don't know what that is. It's sugar. Fish. I'll take a fish. The shields have been battered and scarred in long ago battles. Aodan the Ingenious? Jeez. Oh, I'm battered. Another history. You see a small band of people walking down a rutted road surrounded by a thick forest. This man walks alongside them, chatting and joking like they were lifelong friends. Though his appearance is one of frivolity, his jovial facade is betrayed by the occasional sideways glance into the dense tree line. There is a noise from the trees above them, the sound of someone breaking a twig. The man holds up his hand, silencing the travelers and destroying the light-hearted tone of the evening. They look around, worried expressions on their faces, gathering closer together. The man motions to the group to stay where they are and heads into the trees. There is silence for several seconds as they all strain to hear anything, clutching one another nervously. There is another rustling, this time coming from the direction the man entered the woods. A single figure emerges from the tree line and the group visibly relaxes, seeing him approach. The figure comes close enough for the group to see his face, and one of them lets out a cry of dismay when they realize this is not their friend. No sooner has the sound left his mouth than another group emerges from the woods, weapons drawn, surrounding the travelers. As none of them are armed or in any state to fight, they are quickly subdued, bound, and relieved of their valuables. With a laugh, the bandits disappear back into the woods, leaving their quarry on the road. Safely back inside the forest, they meet up with the man. He smiles, mocking the gullibility of people who will trust a complete stranger as long as he buys them a drink. He takes his share of the spoils and leaves. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to go inside this place, I'm just going to look up here. Surprised we can't look at this statue. Says. Admeth's Den, that's what it says. Oh, is it like Admeth's Wort? Admeth's Wort. It earned its name for association with the final resting place of Admeth Harrat. So this, that's the goose and fox, but there's another place, an unmarked building we can go in over there. And there's two people here. Matthias Nicholas. Another history. You see an immaculate den. Sorry, inn. Dark wood counters gleaming, patrons rowdy and smiling. Two men stand behind the bar, joking as they pour drinks. Features so similar they must be siblings. The younger snatches up an armful of drinks and walks them around the room, chatting happily as he hands out orders. Just as he sets down the final ale and turns around a red-faced Amawa, a red-faced Amawa charges through the door, trailed by three sour-looking elves, slamming directly into him. The Amawa growls, knocking the young man out of the way, and demands an ale from the brother behind the bar. The man refuses, and the rest of the bar falls silent, sensing trouble. The older brother again asks the Amawa to leave, the younger brother placing a firm hand on his back and pushing him towards the door. And the scene freezes. With a sickening crack, the man is knocked backwards into the wall, neck snapping backward before he falls to the floor. He does not get up. The action is immediate as the other patrons come to the barman's aid, dragging the Amawa and his compatriots out the back, but the damage is done. The carpet oozes with blood, slowly seeping into its fibers as one brother dies and the other falls to his knees, horror piercing his eyes. By the time he gets up, the Amawa is long gone. But here he is, I guess. And Kondar freed. You see two men walking slowly down a stone corridor. They move cautiously, frequently looking behind themselves. One of them is this man who stops, bringing a piece of parchment closer to his light enchanted helmet so he can read it. That's cool. While the other keeps walking, glancing over his shoulder, the first man looks up from his parchment in the middle of a sentence and stops, his expression changing from caution to fear. He starts to call out a warning, but is too late. The Zorup, who appeared from the darkness before them, rushes forward and punches its small sword into the stomach of the other man. It then squeals, seemingly repulsed by what is happening, and quickly backs away, leaving the sword protruding from the man's abdomen. Parchment falling from his hand, he leaps forward, catching his friend as he falls. The wound isn't serious. In fact, it doesn't even look like the blade has gone far into his flesh. The man turns his attention back down the hall, looking for signs of movement. Nothing reemerges from the darkness, so he stands and strides down the hall, determination etched on his face, sword and shield at the ready. The corridor starts to widen, and as he enters, a whining yowl erupts from the darkness at the far side of the room. He slows, inching forward toward the sound. The light reveals a Zorup against the wall, holding a smaller one behind it with one arm. The larger Zorup has placed itself between him and the smaller one, attempting to shield the child with its body. The determination fades from the man's countenance as he lowers his shield and sheathes his sword. Putting up his hands, he slowly backs away, leaving the Zorup to care for its young. When the room narrows back into the corridor, he stops. Reaching into his pouch, he removes some rations and places them on the ground before returning to his friend. Oh, that's nice of him. Nicer than the Omawa guy, that's for sure. All right, we're going to check out this... this. And if we have time, we'll head to the Fox and Goose. Thieves hideout. Wasn't I sneaking before I came in here? Langdon? Sleeg? Daisy? Daisy? Dirty Rigbert.
Keeping an eye out.
I mean, he could actually... These guys aren't very good thieves.
I can do that.
A spear and 199 copper skeets. Thank you. Langdon, what sayest thou? Right. Everyone knows the plan? Dirty Rigbert says, up the wall and in the window. Grab the jewel for the pretty little lord. We got it. Listen, dwarf, if I have to... Daisy says, Langdon, we have company. Greetings. The dwarf eyes you suspiciously and hides his pistol behind his back. You, looking for someone? Dirty Rigbert says. Because this isn't the best... Langdon rounds on the dwarf. Idiot, they're probably with the Crucible Knights. You've made a grave mistake coming here. He raises his blade. Oh boy. All right then, if that's the way you want it. Soul Ignition. On this Langdon guy. Magic missile on Langdon guy. Knockdown. You can't cast that yet. Let's have her attack. And the wolfie. And that guy.
Yeah.
Holy Radiance. Fireball. Get these guys. They're starting to run closer, I think, so we'll just go like that. Cast your spell. Is he... You gonna cast this thing? Go, man. Is something going on with him? He's not using it. Is he getting interrupted? I'm not sure. I don't see anything. At least not on a cursory glance. I really just want him to cast a spell. Go! And you might as well just heal everybody. Especially yourself. Where is he anyway? Durance? He's stuck, man. Do you want to cast something else? Is that it? Magic missile or something? Do something. Alright. Just run back here.
How may I help?
You may help by actually casting spells. I mean, that's what I have you for. Alright, we're bugged, obviously, with this crap. Everyone on this guy. Including you.
Let's end this!
Alright, I've had it with the...
Got the priest.
Got the priest? That's no good. See? Because you guys can't frickin' fight. No! Over here! Hit him!
Yes?
Are you serious? Hit that person. Everyone else, hit that person. It's freaking ridiculous. That was frustrating as hell. I hope in the future our wizard can cast spells. It would be helpful. Fine rapier. Rapier. Hide armor. Mail armor. And a thieves letter. Our contract inside Raymond Manor will leave a second story window ajar. He's confirmed the location of the heart of the White March in a hidden chamber. Get your crew together and head to Brackenbury before Lord Raymond moves the jewel AD. I've got a pistol here. Snow caps. A rod and 22 golden skellings. A few bedrolls and spare tunics are bundled in the corner. Long jagged tears slice across the garden scene in this painting.
Got it.
Nothing? Anything?
Quick.
Ah, it's a thieves' den. Of course we'd find something.
Glean quietly.
Moonstones, two of them. If there's anything else. Of course there's that door. Hello. Muddy boot prints and the splotches of ale stain the bed sheets. House Dominil. I'm gonna read this next episode. Fine robe and 11 silver finnings. Ooh, trap detected.
Something over there.
Oh yeah.
What?
Hmm?
That's settled.
Cool. A bloodstone and 86 silver louches.
You can trust me.
Yeah, you sure about that? Oh, there's another. Same with the muddy boot prints and stuff. Dunreed Row. Two books for next time. Those two. Okay. I guess that's it for that. Unless there's secret passageways or something. So, we've explored pretty much everything in Copperlane. Doop doop doop. Maybe we can go down for a quick look and come out right back out, say we found nothing. What's this we? Dalton's your friend, not mine. We talked to a Dalton. Hmm. Okay, so next episode we're going to read two books and we're going to go into the Goose and Fox and talk to this lady. Tell her what we found and we're going to be honest about it. Thanks for watching. See you in the next episode. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.